ईश्वरी चैप्टर 16 वर्स 1 ओवी 16 वी आर सीइंग दैट दिस चैप्टर ऑन दैवी एंड आसुरिक संपत्ति स्टार्टेड दिस टॉपिक वॉज टेकन इन द नाइन्थ चैप्टर एंड ऑल्सो इन द लास्ट चैप्टर दिस दीज वर्ड्स वर मेंशन्ड इन 12th एंड 13th वर्स आई थिंक And when it says the end, that it entering the earth, I sustain all beings with my power. So who are these with all my power? All these are the devas and the manushyas and the asuras. So who is this Gita being told to the manushya? So, and also in the ninth chapter, there also this topic came, and naturally, then what is the what do you call reason? Because the knowledge has been given in 15th chapter, the Purushottam Yoga. Now, why this 16th chapter? So that this seeker, as he is dissolving his I, and as he is dissolving the I, these natures, the I can go either the divine, the what is called the the divine way, or it can go the demonic way, the evil way. So what is the evil way? We will see. It will come from the fourth verse onwards. In the first three verses, all the qualities. So that the seeker recognizes that these are the qualities that are required in order to realize the self. These are the 26, I think 26 or 27 qualities are given, and that will come eventually. And here he says in the quickly, when in this state the dark night of the form of in the form of Maya ends, then who would remember the dream of world appearance and slumber in the form of false knowledge? When the bliss becomes plentiful in this city. So when we are doing the sadhana, we told this last week, in Jnaneshwar Maharaj method is the Kundalini sadhana, and that Kundalini, different ways he has given. He says, take the name of the Lord and the Kundalini will rise. You can do it by the regulation of the breath also. But then eventually what happens? And what happens is this, that first is the physical experience, then second is the mental experience, and then is the transcendental experience. So what is the physical experience as the energy rises? What does energy rising mean? What does rising of the energy connote? purification, isn't it? If the energy is rising from Muladhara to Swadhisthana to Manipur to Anahat to Vishuddhi and so on, which means your mind is purifying. Your mind is becoming single-pointed. Your mind is moving from extrovertism to introvert to becoming introvert, isn't it? This is the natural thing that will start without you willing it, without you wishing it. All you have to do is raise the energy. If you eat the food, you will get satisfied. Simple. You raise it. So this part that on one hand we pursue the path of knowledge, this is what we are doing, which is the royal path, the highest path, and we must make it, how should I say, we must do whatever is required so that this knowledge expresses in our daily life. That is required. And how long are you going to remember everything that you need to practice? You will get tired, isn't it? Then what do you need to do? You need to do some exercise, and that is called, so first is Jnana Yoga, Jnana, and the other is Yoga. So Yoga is doing such exercises with individual. You study the knowledge so that your intellect stays steady in what is the highest, which the words are indicating. But yoga, what it is doing, or Kundalini path for that matter, on a regular daily application of it, you go and sit and connect with that energy or with that japa or with that kriya, whatever it is, what will happen? See, this knowledge which you are gaining through the scriptures, it will not become steady if the mind is not empty. And we are used to living in this world. We have got no other place to go. We are part of this world at this moment. So while living in this world, we need to take some time out where we, instead of applying ourselves in this world, we learn to apply ourselves on ourselves. And that is yoga. So what was karma yoga? Performing actions, wasn't it? Chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5. By the time you came to chapter 5, what was the name of the chapter 5? Karma sannyasa yoga. So you have taken sannyas from the karma itself. But the itch to do karma, the default, has not gone. You have understood, but it has not gone. So where do you apply that karma now? That karma means activity. Where do you apply it? In the sixth chapter, Dhyana Yoga, isn't it? And for Dhyana Yoga, what was the activity? You prepare and the conditions that are required in order for meditation to happen. So same way, here also, Jnaneshwar Maharaj is telling us that if you cultivate these qualities, automatically within your bosom, within your heart and mind, this urge will come that I want to abide in the truth as the truth. But for an unprepared mind, for a mind which is still cluttered with the thoughts of the world, and what are those thoughts? We'll go through each one of them now. It is very difficult. You may understand these scriptures. I studied Bhagavad Gita. I studied this scripture and that scripture. And the problem is that why, if I understand everything, why am I not abiding? Why am I not abiding if I am understanding everything? The error there is lack of regular application on your mind, on yourself. It has to be as regularly as we are eating breakfast, lunch and dinner with some snacks in between. With that regularity, we have to apply ourselves on ourselves. Then this knowledge will start fructifying. And what will be the fructification? Here he says, when in this state, the dark night in the form of Maya ends. In this state, in this transcendental state. The Maya, ignorance. Ignorance end. Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, Maya is equal to incomplete knowledge. Incomplete knowledge of what? Incomplete knowledge about who I am. I at this moment feel I am a body. Or I am a sannyasi, or I am a father, or a mother, or a daughter, or a sister, or a seeker. This is all incomplete knowledge. Then what is complete knowledge? I am of the nature of the self. I am self. After that, no, I am self also. I am. After that, I. After that also goes away. No need to say I. You don't say I am the body every morning, every day. You don't. Then why you have to say I am the self? So, he says, when the bliss becomes plentiful in the city in the form of non-dualism, so as the energy is rising, as our mind is getting purified, what happens? Whenever your desire is satisfied, what happens? Look at anything. Correct. So the moment your desire, the itch in your mind is called the desire, it calms down. That thought goes away. The moment that thought goes away and a new one has not formed, there is bliss. Exactly the same thing, your desire is of sleep, you surrender to sleep and there is no thought thereafter, so you are in deep sleep, you are in bliss. See? But this is inadvertently taking place. Imagine on the seat of meditation, as you are consciously raising or purifying your mind, and the mind starts becoming less and less cluttered, to that extent, what will happen? The joy will start expressing in your out of your mind. You will be happy for no reason. You will be happy for no reason. And imagine, there is nothing in your mind now. Not even the thought of I am. What will be the state of the mind? It will be throbbing with bliss. So here he says, when the bliss becomes plentiful in the city, means in the mind, in the form of non-dualism. Where is dualism? What is the root of dualism? I and the other. Aham and idam. Subject and object, yin and yang, ida and pingala, is the play of these two. The whole world is a play of these two. So don't go, oh, this world is too much. No, come to these two, aham and idam. See? So here he says that in the form of bliss becomes plentiful in the city or in the form of non-dualism, dealings in the form of worldly happiness become slack, and what is more, in the light of this sun comes the bright days in the form of liberation. So what happens? The bliss that you were craving for from the world, which has been put to stop by the corona, you can't go out now. Can't go to party, can't go to cricket, can't go to footy, can't go to soccer, can't go for parties, pubs closed, restaurants closed, cinemas closed. Where will you go? You have to sit at home and introspect. Best way, best time. Nature is forcing you to look into yourself. Take the opportunity. And worldly happiness. And what is more, in the light of this sun comes the bright days of days in the form of liberation. Bright days meaning what? It's a continuous day with no night coming. Liberation is the transcendental state is not that where you continue to be at the mercy of waking, dream, deep sleep, waking, dream, sorry, I should say waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi, waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi. No, there's no fall from there. There's no falling down to incomplete knowledge. There's no falling down into the clutches of Maya. See, you're sorted, the matrix of your mind. That matrix was formed by aham and idam. What is cloth? One thread going this way, one thread going that way, isn't it? What is mind? Consciousness. One consciousness going this way called I, and one consciousness going that way called idam. That. And that is your world. And once all of them start going this way, then there is no cloth. If they are all straight, there is no cloth, meaning there is no mind, not my memory, mind. It's vanished. So where is the mind existing? Where did you say? In its own absence. Where is cloth existing? In its own absence. Actually, it is only thread or cotton, isn't it? So, when, as a result of this, when the mind is fully, the matrix is taken off, is sorted, the hypnosis is over, because aham and idam has been transcended, the aham has transcended, is not interested in the idam, it is looking at itself, then the light that comes about, here it is told, it is the light of liberation, days of liberation, meaning it will be continuous, day in and day out, or day after day, whichever way you put it, it will be that of a bliss, of continuous freedom. When this king in of the sky, which sky? The mental sky. Who is the king of this mental sky in which there is absolute bliss, there is no duality, then what is there in this mind? When we say sky, the sun in the sky. Sky is colorless. Sky is empty. But we see the various colors because of the sun. So when this sun, which is the sun? The self. When this self, the sun, shines in the sky of the mind in which duality is no longer, now what it says then? When this king of the sky in the form of self rises, he does away with the rising and setting. Rising and setting of waking, of rising and setting of waking, rising and setting of dream, rising and setting of sleep, deep sleep, and rising and setting of samadhi. It does away with all these four states. Along setting along with the directions. What are the eight directions? North, south, east, west, north, northeast, northwest, southeast, south. These are the eight directions. And where are these directions possible? Only on the earth. only on the earth. Outside the earth, there is no direction possible. Where is east? It is in reference to that you say, because of the sunrise and sunset, you say it is east and west. There is no sunrise and sunset in the outer space. Now, if you go outside the sphere of the earth, there is no sunrise or sunset. And what was the reason? Because you are seeing the horizon of the earth, that was determining the sunrise, isn't it? Now, in your mind, the sun, meaning the self, is ever risen. No sunrise or sunset, no directions possible, just like in the outside space. And destroying knowledge along with ignorance, very important. Destroying intellect. In intellect, we feel we are ignorant and we feel we are knowledgeable, isn't it? And what have we done to remove the ignorance? Use the words, because if I am ignorant of something, I have to use similar material in order to, I cannot remove the ignorance of the mind with some food. I have to cull out the ignorance of in my understanding with new understanding. Understand? If I have got a bad eye and I need a eye of what do you call that? Organ replacement. I can't replace my eye with someone's nose and say I am replacing the eye. No, I have to replace the eye with the eye, isn't it? That's what you are doing, replacing the individual eye with the total eye. You are replacing the total eye with the infinite eye. Replacing the thought eye with the, and dissolving it into the total eye, infinite eye. Going beyond the eye, that is the transcendental state that is being told. And destroying knowledge along with ignorance. We are thinking all these words of Bhagavad Gita, of Jnaneshwari, they are, oh, great master has written, Upanishads are there, this is the essence of all the Upanishads, such a great, oh, people do puja of this and aarti of the Bhagavad Gita and Bhavartha Deepika. They are fooling themselves. It must be done, no problem with that. But thoughts of knowledge are as ignorant as ignorance itself. So anything that you know by way of thoughts is ignorance. Anything you know by way of experience is also ignorance. Experience, we are saying. So whether it is feeling, whether it is experience, whether it is knowing with support of something. So there in the body we are taking the support of pranayam, etc. We are controlling our senses. We are doing the japa. All this is happening not in... Yes, it is happening, it is all self, but you don't know that. So for the seeker, he has to do this. And as he becomes more and more purified and raises himself in his purification, the lower keeps dropping away as ignorance. The ignorance keeps dropping away. First the body drops away, then the breath drops away, then the mind drops away, emotions drop away, then the convictions drop away, then the idam drops away, then the aham drops away. This is the journey. And all this dropping away was was within this nature only, no? Within this, within the mind only. Mind itself is where the Maya is expressing. Incomplete knowledge is expressing where? In your mind only. It is not expressing in the infinite. It is expressing in your mind. And what is mind? Nothing but thoughts, flow of thoughts. So all thoughts come under the purview of ignorance. So now I have a better understanding of myself and my journey, because now I am listening to different thoughts compared to before. So I replace those thoughts with these thoughts, but I'm still in ignorance. So therefore, here when the Jnaneshwar Maharaj says that this light of the self, which is pervading the sky of the mind, it removes not only directions, not only the Maya or the incomplete knowledge, it also removes knowledge as well as ignorance, once and for all. Now, if you have gone, no, I came to know myself, when you come out, hey, pani dena yaar. If the world is still being perceived as the world, only you will know it. You can fool others. You must have gone to many yogis, or you must have come across, they keep their padukas there. You do namaskar to the paduka, don't touch your dirty hands on my feet. Why? If you touch, my energy will become less. There are people like that, isn't it? Why? They will not eat from hands of anyone. They have a dedicated cook traveling with them everywhere. Why? He makes sattvic. He makes it according to how I like. You have to go beyond it. Think. And destroying knowledge along with ignorance, he displays the knowledge of the self which had been covered by them so long. In short, he creates this unique dawn. This unique dawn. He creates means it's not that he creates. It happens. It happens. But you have to do the sadhana in order to experience this. I heard it from many people, gone through it also, that as the mind becomes settled, then you are watching, then what next? Mind is empty. What next? What next? And suddenly the darkness, the dullness, the inertia in the mind, just like the dawn breaks in the morning and the night is slowly pushed away and the light covers the area that you are in, exactly the same way your mind is covered by the light of the self. It literally happens like that for some. These are all noted experiences by various masters. Then, now from 16th verse, तो अहोरात्रांचा पैलकडू कोणे देखावा ज्ञान मार्तंडू जो प्रकाशये वीण सुरवाडू प्रकाशाचा तयाचित सूर्या श्री निवृत्ती आता नमो म्हणो पुढत पुढती जे बाधका येई जतसे स्तुती बोलाचिया देवाचे महिमान पाहोनिया स्तुति तरी येई जे चांगा वया जरी स्तव्य बुद्धि सीलया जाई जे का जो सर्व नेणे वा जाणिजे मौनाचिया मिठिया मिठिया वाणिजे काहीच न होनी आणिजे आपण पयाजो तया तुझिया उद्देशासाठी पश्यंती मध्यमा पोटी सुने परेसी ही पाठी Vaikhari vire. He says, who can see this sun of knowledge, who is beyond day and night, and who is a globe of self-illumination without the aid of things that illuminate? What are the aids? At a very gross level, sun is illuminating your day, isn't it? That's why you come out of the slumber of sleep. It's very gross outside. Then second,
fire.
Come closer. Then the thought. The thought, the thought of the reality, thought of the Lord, it keeps you inspired all the time. So here he says, who can see this sun of knowledge? Who is beyond day and night can see this sun of knowledge. So you are not subjected to the changes. You are not enslaved by the changes. Day and night means many things. Waker, dreamer, deep sleeper, samadhi. Day and night means I am born in this world. I am living in this world, which presupposes I am the body. So all this has to be dropped away. Day and night, and who is a globe of self-illumination without the aid of things? So you are not you are not in bliss. See, when you are singing the bhajan, at times you may be listening to the satsang and your mind is in bliss. Maja aa gaya. When you are singing bhajan, you get lost in the bhajan. If we continue this Hamza Shiva Zom, you will be lost in it. And after some time, you don't feel like talking, you don't feel like moving, you are just still. But it's temporary. So this stillness was brought about by the support of a mantra. It was not your natural state. It was a temporary one, brought about by some support. So what happens in samadhi? Nirvikalpa samadhi. Every time you go into meditation, you have to start thinking that I have to go into meditation, isn't it? You have to initiate a certain way of contemplation by which you can end up in Nirvikalpa Samadhi every time. Because you have not yet accepted that you are all that there is. You are still considering yourself to be a part of this world. You're still considering yourself to be an individual who needs to liberate. And what is liberation? Coming to this realization, there is nothing else other than me. Nothing else other than the self. That is liberation. So how many times I'm going to go into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, come out? And again, I have to go in, I have to start taking support of my body, take support of my breath, take support of my thinking, contemplation, and then dive into, just like I take the support of the thought of sleep, to dive into sleep, or to surrender to sleep. No, I'm surrendering. I did not do anything. It sucked me into the meditation. Fantastic. Then why are you still here? Why are you still here as an individual to tell that, to speak about it? Then why has your vision not transformed if you are sucked into the self? When I got a clean my Mac, so every time I Mac starts jamming or too much data, I put the clean on Mac, clean my Mac, It scans through all the files and it gives me an option. You want to delete all or you want to just clean what is required to be clean? I say clean. So what happens after I clean? The Mac has more space, isn't it? But if I say clean Mac completely, complete overhaul, reset, then what will happen? I'll have all the space.
Nothing.
Exactly. Same thing is here. No app left behind in the mind. No app of waking, no app of dream, no app of deep sleep, no app of samadhi. Nothing.
Is this why in some texts they talk about the self alone?
The self one without a second. The self alone. So when you take Patanjali Yoga Sutra, there this word is Kevala Sthiti. The last chapter is Kevala Pada or Kaivalya Pada. Kevala means it alone. Means there's nothing else apart from it. Then what is all this so many variety? It's your imagination, projection of the mind. So a self-realized person, for him, self alone is, we are saying that. What is his experience? He also doesn't, he has to use some words. So he says, yeah, what the scriptures are saying, self alone. Because they are the praman. They are the, praman ko kya bolenge? They are the authority. Which, what they are talking about, the great masters have realized. And when those who have studied scriptures or not studied scriptures, but they have come to realization, when they come to read, Ramana Maharishi never read the scriptures, he realized. See? But when he read the scriptures, hey, this is what I was going through. This is what my experience was, what the Upanishads were talking. So he studied the scriptures after realization. He studied Sanskrit after realization. What is the need for studying Sanskrit? And then make compositions in Sanskrit and Tamil? What was the need? It's out of joy. It's out of compassion. Because he sees all that these people coming. He's seeing that all this is not other than me. So automatically the outpouring begins. Get there and find out. So here he says that without the aid of things that illuminate, whatever praise I offer to this sun in the form of consciousness is full of limitations, and so I bow to him again and again. Whatever praise I offer. How do you offer praises? With words. And they are limited in their scope, and therefore I keep offering again and again and again and again. In order to praise the great glory of my master adequately, the intellect has to become identified with the object of its adoration. So here he is talking about his teacher Nivrittinath. And what is he saying? In order to properly adore, the mind must become at one, must have at one ment with the object of adoration. See, those who are thinking of Lord Shiva all the time and very deeply in union with him, even though they have a thought of the Lord Shiva, an image of the Lord Shiva, they start behaving like him, they start living like him. What is living like him? They stop taking bath. In Joshi Math, in one small cave, Joshimath, I met one Mahatma. For 7 years, he had a small Shivalinga there, and the entire small room, it must be just about that much, that's it. And in that, the mountain is coming, and someone has built a wall and one door. And in that room, vibhuti, vibhuti, vibhuti everywhere. Every morning he takes the shower of vibhuti only. Whole day he is doing the puja of the Lord Shiva. He is not, if someone gives him food, he will take. Otherwise, just keep chanting and keep meditating. And we think by going to satsang for 2-3 times a week, we have known a lot. He has been sitting there for last 7 years when I saw him. 7 years, day in and day out. See? So, when we are thinking about, see, if you do Tratak, if you think about the sun all the time, and in when you close your eyes, you see the sun all the time. If you get so identified with the sun, what will happen? You'll get a headache. No. What will you have? What will happen? Your intellect will become bright. The knowledge that the sun has, that knowledge will automatically start expressing through you, which is without any doubt and suspicion, without any error. See? If you contemplate, and there will be tej. But if you are contemplating on moon, you will become cool, calm, isn't it? If you contemplate on Michael Jackson, you will start moonwalking. In Upanishads, there is an example that a pupae in the cocoon, when it is about, how does it complete its last journey? How does it become a butterfly? It has covered itself by its own silk. It is inside, can't see anything. Then the mother comes. You must see it here also. In between the bricks, sometimes you see that mud piece. You see sometimes. So in that pupae, the mother wasp comes. She enters from one side. And look, now this baby inside, he's looking. But what, before there was nothing to look. Now there is something to look. What is he looking at? Does he have any other choice but to look into the eyes of the mother wasp? Looking into the eyes of the mother wasp, he becomes a wasp. When you start thinking about the divine to the exclusion of everything else, then divine will express. When you start thinking about a particular quality without any doubt, without any option, that you become one with that quality. A good actor is he who is at one with his role. He loses his individuality in that role. Then you clap, you say, what a fantastic actor. Isn't it? See, you know, but do you do that? Do you play the role of mother 100%? Do play the role of wife 100%, play the role of angry person 100%, play every role 100%, but without forgetting who you are 100%. So here, as a seeker, if this is how you are performing all the roles, and we appreciate those actors who are doing their roles because they have lost their individuality and taken on that role full on, same thing you have to do. So either you become a devotee of some lord, or you contemplate on the self with such focus, single-pointedness, with such preparation that there is in your mind, even if you don't want to think, the thought of it always is troubling you. What is depression? Today, what is the problem with everyone? Look at everyone around. Everyone is talking whether they want or not. Coronavirus, 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 everywhere, isn't it? What is phobia? Or what is depression? Where involuntarily the thinking is going on in your mind. It has not started by mistake. You have programmed your mind like that. So if that is the case, for phobia, for depression, why don't you program your mind with the name of the God, Lord? And let's see if what will be the result of this experiment. But that is how we function in life, isn't it? Our mind functions. So here he says that, I bow to him again and again in order to praise the great glory of my master adequately. The intellect has to become identified with the object of its adoration. And who is the object of adoration for Jnaneshwar Maharaj? Nivrittinath. Nivritti means the one who is withdrawn. And Nath, he is the master of the all those who are withdrawn from the world. See? Then, if I am thinking about a guru who is ever withdrawn from the world, yet functioning in the world, then my mind will also be automatically be withdrawn, isn't it? Isn't my mind withdrawn from the world when it exclusively thinks about sleep every night? But sleep is a state of ignorance. At the moment you are going to sleep, you replace the thought of sleep with self, replace the thought of sleep with the Lord. See the magic happen then? It's a gateway. Because naturally your mind is quiet. All you have to do is change the track. Instead of sleep, Daivik Sampati. What was sleep? Asurik Sampati. Same chapter. The articulate speech vaikhari along with the inarticulate speech para, pashyanti and madhyama fade away in praising your good self who becomes known with the cessation of all empirical knowledge of worldly things, who can be praised adequately only through silence and who is attained only with the elimination of the ego. So what is vaikhari?
The expressed
What is vaikhari?
Expressed voice.
Expressed thought, not voice. Expressed thought is vaikhari. What is madhyama? Unexpressed thought. Unexpressed speech. The source of vaikhari. Vaikhari is gross, madhyama is subtle, pashyanti is causal, and para is transcendental. Otherwise, vaikhari is waking, madhyama is dream, pashyanti is deep sleep, samadhi is para, the transcendental. What is vaikhari? In the waking, isn't it? What is the speciality of the waking state? Understand, no object in this world can become your experience without a thought. So what is the conclusion? The word is in your mouth and the object of your word is in out there, isn't it? So if I say the word Colin, Colin is in my mouth, but the object called Colin, that word is representing, is out there. The word and the object, they are separate. That is vaikhari. What is madhyama? Think, this is your journey. What is madhyama? Where the thought and the object of the thought, both are in the mind. They are expressing. They are not expressing. They are expressing, but as thought. They are both expressing as thought. And what is pashyanti? Pashyanti is where the thought and the object of the thought, both of them are unexpressed. They are in the seed form. The possibility of their expression is there. So when you go to sleep, the possibility are all the memories that he is my husband, he is my wife, these are my children. All these thoughts have gone into the pashyanti in the seed form only to manifest again the next day, isn't it? This is pashyanti. This is what is happening to you daily. Waking, speech and the object of the speech is separate. In dream, the thought and the object of the thought, both are in the mind only. In the deep sleep, all of them are in the seed form. And para is when we have transcended the waking, we have transcended the dream, we have transcended the deep sleep, and we have got absorbed in the self. Not permanently, temporary.
But where does the seed form exist?
In emptiness, in nothingness, in ignorance. In ignorance. It has got no... It has got... Yes, projection. Mirage has got no seat. It's existing yet not existing. That is why it is called an illusion. Isn't it? The rainbow, it's there yet it's not there. The blueness of the sky, it's there yet it's not there. Exactly the same way. The dream seems to be there when you are in the dream, but actually when you wake up, it's not there. Exactly the same way is this waking experience also. It seems to be there, but actually it is not there. Then what is there? Only the truth is there. We haven't got the eye to see it. So here he's talking about how I can come to make that king appear. How can I gain the liberation? He says that is possible only when I have utter devotion towards my Guru Maharaj, who is Nivrittinath. And then he says that he becomes the object of my adoration. And when I start adoring him, it begins with the gross speech. Oh my Gurudev Maharaj, oh Nivrittinath ki jai, Guru Maharaj ki jai. But slowly, slowly, as I become, lose my identity with him, with my object of contemplation. So some people see the Shirdi Sai Baba or their Guru Maharaj photograph and they look at it and they go into meditation. So what has happened? They have absorbed themselves in the idea that they were contemplating upon, isn't it? And this is how you are functioning in life also. You have absorbed yourself into your wife, therefore you are working as husband. You have absorbed yourself in your children, therefore you are, by default, you are functioning as parents. You have absorbed yourself in the world, therefore you are worried about what world will think about you, talk about you, comment about you. Because you have absorbed yourself into thinking that this world is real and I am, we are a social animal, all these words. Economics has absorbed itself into thinking. Some person only thought that distribution of scarce resources. There is no scarcity, yet they created a subject, distribution of scarce resources is economics. And with this wrong interpretation, with this long conclusion about life, then see what damage we are creating. Generations after generations after generations are coming who are believing that there is not enough in this world. When there is not enough in this world, you see what is happening in the supermarkets today. All shelves are empty. Why? There is not enough. The scarcity is created. There is enough. But for that there is enough, you have to believe it. Forget about the world. You must believe. Then from where it will come, that's not your concern. From where it will come is not your concern. Nature takes care. Someone asked, last Bhagwat, someone said, oh Swamiji, I have to get the car serviced and I have to change this and it's going to be that expensive. He said, oh really? Oh, this, that. And then they said, I said, I'm tired. Oh, why don't you take the Eastlink to go home? I said, pay, I'll go. No, Swamiji. But it's an experiment. Last 22 years, first 7 years, I didn't even have a bank account. Only 13 years I have had the bank account with whatever is there. I don't own anything. I don't earn anything. And if I use something, it's replaced with whatever I have or I get. But there is no collection of any damn thing in this in last 22 years. It's an experiment with myself, not to be imposed on anyone. No organization, no business, no sanstha organization ho gaya na, no temple, no ashram. See, mind is free. Find out some experiment in your life. While living, you have to experiment. You cannot run away from the world and experiment. While living in this world, you have to keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. So here, master is all the student, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he is keeping at adoring his master. First, from outside, how do you adore the master outside? Through your gross speech, then through your subtle speech. When you are sitting in the meditation, you invoke the master, please bless me in my, I'm going to start the meditation. The subtle speech, then the causal speech. Here he says, all these three speeches are incapable of illuminating the Guru Maharaj. Incapable. Why? Who is Guru? Who is beyond experience. Who is beyond experience. Mind waking. At the Vaikari Madhyama Pashyanti, it is having an experience of dullness is deep sleep, or Pashyanti is dullness. See, so he says that all these three, the articulate speech, Vaikari, along with the inarticulate speeches, Para, Pashyanti and Madhyama, fade away in praising your good self, praising the Guru Maharaj. Yato vacho nivartante, That means yataha vachaha nivartante. Nivartante means return. This truth, this principle, this guru principle is that which cannot be illuminated by the speech. And we, when we use this statement, it's automatically, gross, subtle, causal and transcendental speech cannot illuminate the guru principle. Even para cannot illuminate. When does it get illuminated? When para merges, loses itself, loses its identity. So first you lose the identity of the deep sleeper, then the dreamer, then the waker, then you lose the identity of I, the meditator. Then the revelation happens. Your good self, who becomes known with the cessation of all empirical knowledge of worldly things. Empirical knowledge, worldly knowledge. What is another meaning of empirical knowledge? That knowledge which comes and goes. So how do we know everything in our life? By thoughts. Thoughts come and go. Empirical. Another meaning for empirical, phenomenal knowledge. Thought is a phenomena. Mind is a phenomena in which the thoughts happen, isn't it? So this phenomenal knowledge, this empirical knowledge, this thought knowledge is incapable of or unqualified for knowing your good self. And you are who can be praised adequately only through silence, and who is attained only with the elimination of the ego. So two things. First is, no articulation can ever illuminate. So Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, Guru Jai Jai, Guru Maharaj, Guru Jai Jai, nothing will happen. But it is necessary in the initial stages. So we are talking about the ultimate consummation. So there, ego first, the mind must be silent, and in that silence all objectivity must disappear, because objectivity will be for the I, for the ego, for the individual, isn't it? So if the ego individual is saying, oh, my mind is silent, and he sits quiet. You can be sitting quiet for eons. Gundavlekar Maharaj's story, it comes now. That this person, he's been meditating on Lord Ram for many cycles of creation. And Gundavlekar Maharaj goes inside the mountain, wakes him up, and the first question he asked is, has Ram taken birth? And this was Kali Yuga, about 80, 90 years ago. So Gundavlekar, yeah, he came in Treta Yuga, now it is Kali Yuga. He says, again I missed him. This is what happens when we go into silence. There and then, Gundavlekar Maharaj gave him the experience of Ram. But it was not of the self, of Ram. And he said, my life is over. I don't need anything else to. That's what I was waiting for. I had the darshan of Ram. He turns his body into ashes straight there and then. Otherwise, for so many cycles of creation, he was sitting there in the subtle body, waiting for Lord Ram to appear. But in his meditation, he has forgotten the cycle of time. This is what happens when you go into silence. This is the nihilist philosophy, going into silence. We want to go to conscious silence. So, the one who knows there is silence, we want to be that one. Not looking at silence, but as one with the one who knows that the mind is silent. Silence is not our end game of life. In the nihilist philosophy, because it is silence, Akash and silence is one and the same. Therefore, the cycle of life continues for such a person. They don't liberate. But if you do in that silence, chitta vritti nirodha iti yogaha, you have reached silence. Chitta vritti nirodha, zero thoughts. Chitta, thoughts, sorry, mind, vritti, thoughts, nirodha, zero thoughts. Iti yoga. That is silence. But if you stop there, incomplete. Next sutra, third sutra of Patanjali Yoga Sutra says, tada, then, after having reached this state of silence, then, tada, drashtuhu, see, swarupe avasthanam, see your own self in that silence. Who is aware of this silence? Someone is watching. That I am. Shift the attention from the silence. You can't, it's not that you are looking out there and you have to look in here. That is, otherwise you will create more thoughts. So you are there. Mind is empty. Rather than focus on the silence, be aware of the one in whose presence the silence is able to express. Be that one. Then it is complete. Then it is liberation. And this you can do, tada drashtu swarupe avasthanam, if you do, only then you can go into nirvikalpa samadhi also. But if you want to make this tada drashtu swarupe avasthanam into a liberation, then you have to study Vedanta. Without it, not possible. You have to pursue the knowledge. How this self alone is the total and transcendental, and how this self alone is the material and the creator of the whole creation without having created anything. For that, this knowledge is required. Otherwise, going into silence is very easy. Going into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, so many times you are going into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, you don't know how to recognize it, but you are going many times during the day. Hmm? 21st. Taya tute ke trute? Taya tute mi sevakapane. लेववी बोलके आस्तोत्राचे लेणे हे उपसाहावे ही मनता उणे अद्वयानंदा परीरंके अमृताचा सागरू देखिलिया पडे उचिताचा विसरू मग करू धावे पाहुणेरू शांकाचा तया ते तशा कुहिकीर बहुत म्हणावा तयाचा हर्ष वेगुची तो ध्यावा उजळोनी दिव्य तेजाहातिवा ते भक्तीची पाहावी बाळा उचित जाणणे होय तरी बाळपणची के आहे परी साचची एरी माये म्हणवनी तोषे हा गा गा वरसे भरले पाणी पाठी पाय देत आले ते गंगा काय म्हणितले परते सर. He says, if I were to request you to be pleased with the ornate hymns of praise, it will diminish our blissful state of unity. If I use words to praise, then I'm creating difference between the guru and myself. See? So how is this adoration of the guru? As a principle, not as a person. I shouldn't say not as a person, as a principle, as an idea, whatever. It is all that there is. Guru is the ultimate. It is the foundation. It is the substratum. So what is, how is this adoration? Eloquent silence. That is his adoration. So he's not using any words. Yet, yeah, not surrendering, wandering, nothing is like that. Jnaneshwara Maharaj is very clear that he and the Guru are one. He has got no doubt as to that he is a disciple and he is, for the worldly sake, he uses all that language. Because when you use the language, if I say that I am the same as my teacher, that will be taken as arrogance. Even though that is how his abidance is not other than the Guru, other than the Lord. But if he says that, people will misunderstand. And that's not the right, it's not because of the people he doesn't want to say it, but it's not the right thing. See? So he says, the moment I start adoring my teacher, my Guru Maharaj, with words, it will bring about separation. I'll have to come one step down. Again, Ahamidam will be created. The state of union will be corrupted from there, that moment onwards. So he says here that if I were to request you to be pleased with the ornate hymns of praise, it will diminish our blissful state of unity. When a poor person coming across the sea of nectar does not know what hospitality should be extended to it, offers it vegetable dishes, that meal should be reckoned as a feast after taking into account the fervor with which it is offered. If someone were to wave the wick lamp before the sun, he should not think it as a lesser form of worship, but view it in the light of his devotion. So if Jnaneshwara Maharaj is singing the praises of his Guru Maharaj, just like a person saying Om Na Tatra Suryo Bhati Na Chandra Tarakam, to the sun, to the Lord, in your heart you know Lord is transcendental, infinite, yet you are praying to the statue in front of you, or the photograph in front of you, or the Guru Maharaj in front of you. If someone were to wave the wick lamp before the sun, he should not think as a lesser form of worship. Worship in any form towards the higher is valid, is accepted, it is necessary. Otherwise, arrogance will come, pride will come, feeling I am greater than everyone, that will come. Worship, but view it in the light of his devotion. Who would call it a child if it knows what is good for it? But the mother feels happy at its ignorant chatter. So he's talking about on one hand he's talking about himself. He's only, how old is he when he's talking about the Bhavartha Deepika, giving the lecture? He's only 12 or something around that age. Amrut Anubhav he wrote towards the, when he was 1920. 21 he left, he took Samadhi. This is just after the Brahma Sabha. After that he gave lectures on Bhavartha Deepika. He was very young. So he's saying, if I'm talking about my Guru, take it as my devotion. Take it in that sense. Then, and just like if my many places it has happened, even in Satya Sai Baba's life, if you read his biography, when he was young, parents used to be angry with him. Why don't you go to school? Why do you skip school? And he used to sit on a tree and keep looking into the sky. Ammachi, her brother wanted to kill her. Her parents were fishermen and they did not understand what this girl was all about. She used to sit on the banks of the canal and sit in meditation, and sometimes, and the fish used to feed her. They are fishermen. The eagle or the crows, they used to catch the fish and put it in her lap. And people looking around, everyone looking in meditation, she would fall into the canal, they will bring her out. And as she matured, again, never studied any scriptures. But she knows now all the scriptures. That time in the younger age, no scriptures. And you don't have to read scriptures. When a mind is so single-pointed and the mind is silent, when mind is single-pointed and it is silent, no corruption, if you put your attention on that, I want to know scriptures, knowledge becomes available. Whichever way it is supposed to come. In that meditation, I wanted to, what I am experiencing in meditation, samadhi, I want to experience 24/7. The only next step that will make it possible is Vedanta. And one day in meditation, Akashvani, Shastron ka adhyayan karo, three times. And within 6 months, I found myself in an ashram. Within 6 months, how the whole thing worked out, you can't imagine, you can't plan it yourself. But it happened. See? So I went to ashram. Shirdi Sai Baba, he didn't go to ashram. He sat in meditation. Satya Sai Baba, he didn't go to ashram. Ammachi, she didn't go to ashram. Naneshwar Maharaj, he didn't go to ashram. So then how did he get all the knowledge? How? All knowledge is available in the space, in the Akash. And the sound of Akash is Om. And if you hold on to the Om when the time comes, that knowledge will automatically, when it is required, now you know, the urge is there to know the knowledge, it starts flowing out of you. We did the long way. Some debts to clear of guru disciple, of ashram, of some other people. Maybe there is a debt, therefore we are all coming together. Or a smarter way to look at it is all happening in bliss. When we think about the world, then it is a debt. So anyway, so here Naneshwar Maharaj says, just like their parents, all these masters, I said, their parents were ignorant. They did not know what their child, that there is a gem in the house and they are persecuting them, scolding them. See? But the knowledge was there in that child. Similarly, Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, you are all elders because so many hundreds and thousands of people are sitting. He is only 12-year-old. He is a child. And so he is saying that who would call it a child if it knows what is good for it? You call him a wise person. Who knows? You call that person a wise. You don't call that person a child. Child is that person who's dependent. Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he is not dependent. He is independent. He is more wise than all the people there and the pandits, the shastris, the upholders of religion, so called. He is wiser than them. He has taught them a lesson. Who would call it a child if it knows what is good for it? But the mother feels happy at its ignorant chatter. So now this is where his humility comes in. He says, yes, I am a child. I am speaking in front of all of you who are so well versed in the scriptures. You are elder to me. You are like my grandparents, grandfather, etc. Such great shastric knowledge you have. So just take my speaking as a childish talk. Don't take too seriously. Ignorant chatter. See, if a stream comes to join the Ganga with its dirty water, does the latter tell it to go back? If a stream comes to join the Ganga, does Gangaji tell, no, you are dirty, get away? It doesn't. So same way, please accept me the way I am, Jnaneshwar Maharaj is telling. Does the latter tell it to go back? No. Then in the 25th verse, we will see it in our 26th onwards, we will see it in our next class. Some story of Bhrigu Maharaj is being told there. So we'll see it. All introduction only. 26th. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Just sit quietly for a minute, 2 minutes.